On behalf of the family of Lynn Rosema, I welcome you today to a time to remember. To remember the beautiful gift of God that has been given to so many through the life of Lynn Rosema. A time to remember the promises of God that hold us in life and carry us when we face death together. And so I welcome you to this time of remembering the goodness of our God and his grace and his mercy. The family invites you to join with them not only in these moments together in the sanctuary, but if you are able to stay and to join them for some refreshments immediately following our time together this morning. The words of the psalmist are our call to worship today from Psalm 121, and I invite you to read responsively the words in bold print in your order for the day. The psalmist writes, "I lift up my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth." Many people from the congregation here at Emmanuel have been praying for the Rosema family in these past years, and especially in these past days and in these past hours. And I wrote a specific request to the elders of this church to be in prayer last night. And one of them replied with a prayer that he wrote out from Brian Van Zanten. And I'd like that to be our prayer as we begin this morning. Let us pray together. O Lord our God, we often begin our days by acknowledging you and the need for your involvement in the day ahead. This is normal and good. But then there are days which are not normal, and we recognize a greater need of you. Today is one of those days, God. Pour out an extra measure of your Spirit today as you speak to the family and friends of our sister, Lynn Rosema. We often use words like comfort, peace, and assurance at times like this. Lynn already had these things. Her journey to you in these past months is a powerful testimony of the Spirit of God in her. We noticed it, God. We saw it in her actions, heard it in her words, felt it in her passion as she walked that torturous path a third time. Thank you for giving us the gift of Lynn Rosema. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Words that are precious to the saints of this church and to Ron and Lynn and their family are the beautiful expression of faith that is included in the words of the first question and answer of the Heidelberg Catechism. It's included in your order for today, and I'd like to read the question and invite us together to respond with the answer. The question is this: what is your only comfort in life and in death? That I am not my own, but belong body and soul in life and in death to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. He has fully paid for all my sins with his precious blood and has set me free from the tyranny of the devil. He also watches over me in such a way that not a hair can fall from my head without the will of my Father in heaven. In fact, all things must work together for my salvation. Because I belong to him, Christ by his Holy Spirit assures me of eternal life and makes me wholeheartedly willing and ready from now on to live for him. We have one addition to the order that's in front of you today, and Ron and Lynn's daughter, Chris, is going to share a few reflections with you at this time.
I had to get my iron out today, Mom, and I hate ironing. You were lucky. I remember Grandma coming to our house on Wednesday mornings and doing your ironing for you. Again, lucky for you, we came into a time where clothes didn't need ironing as often, because I would have totally called on you for that job and had a day where you would come and do that for me. I did as best as I could, so I hope my guys' shirts look okay today. We miss you so much already. You have left such a big hole, Mom. But please don't worry about us. I know your last few days, we were all you thought about. I know you felt like you were giving up. And I know at one point you said, "I'm sorry," to Dad. You were tired, and that's okay. You fought so hard these last few months, and I know you did it for all of us, and we are all so proud of you. We will take good care of Dad. He said last night that the condo has suddenly gotten a lot bigger. He has to find a new normal, but I have a feeling that will not be a problem. It won't happen right away, but he will find plenty to do, and I think you know that. I have a feeling sometime in the future even, he'll be heading back to Liberia or Africa or somewhere else and help people there. You know how passionate he was about doing that. I know that you would love to see him do that. He will continue to follow his grandkids to swim meets, hockey games, and basketball games. The swim families will welcome him with open arms like they always have. And hopefully those other sporting communities are ready for him, because he thinks his grandkids are kind of a big deal. He will probably go drive Corey crazy occasionally. And as the weather gets warmer again, all of us now have our own lawn service. He will always love you, but you know that too. You are the love of his life, and I know you know that. You and Dad had the marriage that some dream about, and not everybody has that. You are a testimony to so many. You always put God at the top and made sure that us kids, as we started our married lives, knew that that would be the only way to make our marriage truly work. Thank you for always loving us kids unconditionally. We all gave you a run for your money and many sleepless nights, but you were always there. I hope I can be half the mom to my kids that you were to us. I hope you are having the time of your life in heaven. I hope you and Grandma Rosema aren't getting into too much trouble together. I know you are in your flip-flops, basking in the warm sun, enjoying your sweet granddaughter, Raylin, and so many others that have gone before us. We love you so much.
Thank you, Chris. Heather and Rachel are going to lead you today in worship, and Ron made it pretty clear that even though today will be full of tears, he would love to hear your joyful singing. I think he even used a word like rock concert, but we're not sure we'll do that today or we're able to pull that off. But to make a joyful noise that makes heaven smile, I know you're capable of that today, and Rachel and Heather are going to help you do that with the power of his love.
Thank you.
Kevin, Ron and Lynn's son. I'd like to share some scripture with you today, scripture that reminds him of his mom so much.
So I'm reading from her Bible here, and there's no back cover anymore. I mean, a wife of noble character, who can find? She is worth far more than rubies. Her husband has full confidence in her and lacks nothing of value. She selects wool and flax and works with eager hands. She is like the merchant ships bringing her food from afar. She gets up while it is still dark and provides food for her family and portions for her servant girls. She considers a field and buys it out of out of her earnings. She plants a vineyard. She sets about her work vigorously. Her arms are strong for her tasks. She sees that her trading is profitable and her lamp does not go out at night. In her hands, she holds the distaff and grasps the spindle with her fingers. She opens her arms to the poor and extends her hands to the needy. I mean, come on. She opens her arms to the poor and extends her hands to the needy. When it snows, she has no fear for her household, for all of them are clothed in scarlet. She makes coverings for her bed. She is clothed in fine linen and purple. Her husband is respected at the city gate, where he takes his seat among the elders of the land. She makes linen garments and sells them and supplies the merchants with sashes. She is clothed with strength and dignity, and she can laugh at the days to come. She speaks with wisdom, and faithful instruction is on her tongue. She watches over the affairs of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children arise and call her blessed, her husband also, and he praises her. Many women do noble things, but you, Mom, surpass them all. Charm is deceptive and beauty is fleeting, but a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Give her the reward she has earned, and let her works bring her praise at the city gate.
Amazing grace, how sweet.
Lynn's family know how much you loved her and how much she loved you, and they wanted to provide some space today if some of you, probably a few of you, had some words to share of reflection or thankfulness to God for memories that you share and hold fast to today. There's an opportunity and space for you to do that now. Of course, when we do this, we have no idea if any of you will come up or if all of you would want to stand in line. We're hoping we'll be somewhere in between, and we'll leave some space right now. If anyone would like to come up and share a reflection, you can use this microphone right here. You can just leave it on the stand. You can take it out of the stand as well if that's better for you.
I'm being here. I'm so happy to be part of the Rosemont family. I'm so blessed. Mom was a truly blessing for me and my kids. She loved me so much, and she loved my kids like her own. I came from Africa. She taught me so much. She teach me how to switch the light on. She teach me how to use the microwave. She teach me how to use the shower, and then she teach me how to use the laundry, the machine, the washer. I remember I put my clothes in the washer. I didn't have many clothes in it. It was a few of them, so the washer was kind of shaking. I was afraid, and I screamed, "Kevin!" And he said, "Wow." I said, "The machine's broke." He said, "No, it's not broke. You don't have too many clothes in there." I said, "No, leave me alone, Mom." She said, "Why?" And then she ran from the shower. She came. She said, "Oh, you're fine, Ida. You don't have too many clothes in there." I said, "But I'm afraid." She said, "I'll stay here with you until the clothes is washed." So she stayed with me and clothes until I finished washing my clothes. I want to go to the store. If Land Rosemont didn't take me, it would be Marianne. That's the first house I ever entered. It was in Rosemont's house. The first shower I ever had was in Rosemont's house. I wish I had a way to bring her life back, but only God can do that. God gives and He takes away. He knows. And I'm so thankful that she's resting in peace because she suffered a lot. Mom, you live in my heart forever, me and my kids. I'll never stop loving you. You mean everything to my kid. My son Junior won't open his eyes to look at me. He just crying. I don't know what to do. But she's gone, I know. The kids are here. And we're still family. And I love all of you for coming here. Being in my life and my children, myself, I won't be standing here if it wasn't for Rosemont opening her arm from the airport to bring me into her home, welcoming me into her family. We went through a lot. I remember downstairs when I was sleeping, the telephone was ringing. I'm like, "What is that?" I got so scared. And I took the blanket and I covered it up, but it won't stop ringing. It kept ringing and ringing and ringing. I opened the door and I flipped. I went upstairs. She said, "Well," I'm like, something just buzzing in the room. I don't know what is that. She went there. She said, "Oh, I won't plug it. That's a telephone." She did. She is so precious. She loves everybody. She don't care who you are. She doesn't care about the color, where you're from, your background. She's a wonderful woman, and we will miss her. And I love her forever in my heart. Thank you for everything.
We're gonna miss Lynn. Lynn was like a special angel to me and to all of us at New City Kids. Trevor and I have only known the Rosemas for the last 2 years since we moved here, but I know that we've known them for a really long time because your church and you guys have been praying for us ever since we've had a relationship with you, which is over 20 years. And anyway, Lynn would come every week last year to Brighter Day on Wednesday nights, and it was beautiful, the scripture you read of Proverbs 31, because at one point she and Marianne brought a beautiful basket full of handmade Afghans. And they did that because the church that we use, there are times when there's heat and then there's times when there's not heat. And our group of girls who have been extremely damaged in their young lives, we would all be sitting there huddling without very much heat for our meeting. And this beautiful basket of Afghans came. And we could just bundle up. And that was just a metaphor for the kind of love that Lynn poured out to us. And you guys have done that ever since we moved here. There was so much love in very practical ways, and we are just so grateful. So on behalf of everybody at New City and Trevor and I, we love you guys, and we thank you, and the whole New City family thanks you.
I'm so thankful that I'm here today, even though she was a nice lady. She was so nice to us. When the winter came, during the winter, I would put summer clothes on the boys. And then when summer time came, I put winter clothes on my kids. She would come over and say, "Betty, no, you don't do that." She would go in my kids' closet and get all their summer clothes and pull it away. And then take the winter one and pull it in. And she said, "This is what you should use for the kids. You want the kids to die from the snow?" No. And Edward was like, "Mom always put short pants on or during the winter time." And she was so nice. She was always in our life. She was always there for us. She would go over to the house and check on the kids. Sometimes I saw you guys come over to come and swim during the winter time. No, summertime, sorry. And I went over to her house, want to swim, and I wore short pants because I didn't have a bathing suit. And I wore short pants. She said, "Betty, you gonna get in the pool with that?" "Yeah." "No, you can't do that." I said, "Yeah." And she gave me bathing suit, and I put a bathing suit on, and I swim. And I was like, getting dry. She threw me in the pool. She saved me from the water. And I drank enough of the water. She was so nice. She was a nice lady. I can remember once she met me and Aida walking down on 32nd. I think she gave some clothes to Aida. And the clothes didn't fit Aida, and Aida gave it to Betty. And she met us, we were walking, she stopped the car. "Aida, did you give the pants to Betty that I gave you?" Aida said, "Yeah." And she was like, okay, but I give it to you. I didn't give it to Betty. So Aida was a little bit upset about that, and we talked about it. Aida said, we don't do that in Africa when we give somebody something. We pass it on to the other person. But Lynn was a nice lady. I used to call her mom. And she was like a mother to me. Even her kids, I don't know them too good, but I guess I know Kevin. And the other one, the rest of them, yeah. And they know me. Whenever they see me, hi, Betty. But I asked God to forgive me. Because the few times she was sick, I didn't see her. And I didn't even know that she passed away. It was Marion, the one that told us. But Ben went to the shop, to Marion's shop, last night. And we got to know that she passed away. And it got to me because I didn't see her. And she didn't see the boys again. So I asked God to forgive me for that. And I know she forgave me for that. So I'm sorry to the bereaved family.
I don't even know where to start. I think I'll start at the beginning. People have asked me how we got together, how Lynn and I got together as friends. I don't know how we were on the phone on a certain day. It was after our youngest son was born, and there was a lot of medical issues we weren't aware of yet, but Jared would literally stop breathing, just boom, and I'd have to shake him. I had to get him to the hospital. I had two other kids at home. And Lynn's on the phone for whatever reason with me, and she says, I will bring Christy over. She can watch Joel and Joni. I will take you to the hospital so you can hang on to Jared and don't have to worry about him in the car seat. And from then on, it was history. And I'm just so thankful for her life and for her gift of friendship. But that was just one way. That's how we met, and that's her giving, you know, that's her legacy. And I'm so thankful she's whole and well. We prayed for healing, and she is healed. Just not what I would have wanted. But I also know she is happy because she hated being on so many medications and so many pills, and she hated that. And she don't have to worry about that anymore. Love her.
Thank you for sharing your hearts with one another today. You'll have more time to do that with the Rosamas in the Family Life Center over refreshments, but I couldn't help but think, watching Ida and Betty come up, who would have ever thought that a woman in Hudsonville would have such a deep impact on women who came from all the way across the ocean and the other side of the world? Only God could work that out, and so we give him praise today. He is faithful, and that's the next song we sing, Great is Thy Faithfulness. As our worship leader comes up, I had the privilege of being with the Rosamas at the hospital in the last few days of Lynn's life, and to witness a hospice nurse come in and sing to her, and she sang the song that you already sang, The Power of Your Love, and then she also sang this song that you're about to sing to Lynn, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Great is
God is our provider. Throughout the years, I have watched God provide for Ron and Lynn and their family in numerous ways. And one of them is by giving to them truths from His Word that carry them through seasons of life. If there was one scripture that I would identify with the Rosamas the most, it would be these words from Isaiah chapter 43, where it says, "But now this is what the Lord says, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have summoned you by name, you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. When you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior." Ron told me that those words were given to them by God as truth to hold on to and truth that would hold them when he was severely injured during a softball game. And then through Lynn's first cancer surgery, and then beyond. They became words that not only held them, but they gave to others again and again and again. I just don't know how many times I've heard those words come out of Ron's mouth. You walk through the waters, and you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. God is our provider, and he has been faithful. But those are not the words for today, because God chose to give to Ron and Lynn and their family some different words, also from the prophecy of Isaiah chapter 41, verse 10. Words that they had put on display in their home, and then the same words confirmed again and again and again in the last hours of Lynn's life, and then in the days to follow, these same words. And so there was no doubt for Ron that this would be the centerpiece verse of our time together today. Isaiah 41, verse 10. God says, "So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." These beautiful words of Scripture represent God's love and care for his people. And I believe Lynn Rosema was so deeply loved by so many of you because she so often was such a good reflection of the love and kindness of her great God and Savior. She reflected that to you. That's why you're here today. Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. As I was trying to put together so many thoughts that Ron's family shared with me in these last days, and these words, I thought about three ways that God interacts with us that are summarized here. God is present with us. He's personal and enormously practical. He's present, he's personal, and practical. That's the first word he gives. I'm present with you. Do not fear, for I am with you. I'm with you. It's my presence. You don't have to be afraid. Lynn had lots of reasons to be afraid in the last few decades, battling cancer three times. But as I asked her and talked to her again and again, it just became evident that most of the time, she was not afraid. Most of the time, maybe all of the time, she was not angry with God. And as I poked and prodded here and there, I realized she was not faking it. It was her, to the depth of her heart and soul. She knew God was with her. She knew the power of God's presence. And God's presence always brings a peace to a heart and soul that passes understanding. And when you talk to Lynn, you really couldn't explain it. It was beyond understanding. She was at peace because God was present with her. And as God was present with Lynn, you have had the chance to observe, as I have, that Lynn was present with those around her. As God was present with Lynn, you've been able to observe that Lynn was also present with Ron, her husband. She was with Ron in marriage for 44 years. Their marriage seemed to be a simple thing and a beautiful thing at the same time. Ron loved to be with Lynn. Lynn loved to be with Ron. Simple and beautiful. It wasn't always easy. But many years ago, the God's gift of marriage encounter, even over 20 years ago, I believe, made it easier and easier. Not that their life got any easier, but they prioritized their relationship above every challenge that came their way. And when they started doing that, the more that they did that, the more the time seemed to fly by. And strange as it may sound, 44 years, much too short. Ron referred to Lynn as my darling. You might be wondering, who in the world still talks like that? What does it mean, my darling? Well, let me assure you, all you have to do is hear Ron refer to Lynn as his darling one time. And by the tone of his voice and the look on his face and the love in his heart, you will know fully what my darling means just by the way he said it. If you looked it up, you'd find this. Darling means one dearly loved, period. My darling. As God was present with Lynn, Lynn was present with Ron, her husband. As God was present with Lynn, Lynn was present with her family. I can do this for 5 years. That's what Lynn said with regard to her most recent chemo treatments. Treatments that came in 3-week cycles, which included one terrible week, one not quite as terrible, and then 1 week knowing that it would be terrible again in a few days. She said, I can do this for 5 years. Why? Because it was worth it to her. She would endure treatments for the sake of having more time with her family, her husband, her kids, her grandkids, and with you, her friends. As God was present with Lynn, Lynn was present with her family. As God was present with Lynn, Lynn was present with her friends. The best place to be present was poolside. Their pool, the Rosamond Pool, was a place to gather, a place to spoil grandkids, a place to make memories. Memories like going down the slide for the first time. It was a place to host parties, and it was generously offered as a place for you to host your party at their house. Many of you will remember holding hands and praying around the pool. 20 of you, 30 of you, 40 of you, 50 of you, almost 60 of you at one time at the Rosamond Pool. And everyone felt Lynn's warm welcome. As God was present with Lynn, Lynn was present with her friends. And as God was present with Lynn, Lynn was present with God. You see, that pool was not just a place to host gatherings of family and friends. It was also a sanctuary. It was a place to commune with God. In the midst of tending flowers or even vacuuming the pool, it was a place of quiet consecration, of reflection, devotion, of intimacy with God. It was a place of peace. As God was present with Lynn, Lynn was present with God. These words of Isaiah remind us, so do not fear, for I am with you. God says, I'm present with you. But God says, I'm also personal. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. As God had a close personal relationship with Lynn, Lynn, as you would expect, had a close personal relationship with her husband and with her children. Do not be dismayed, God says. He says, do not live your life gazing about, looking for something other than him that will give you your true north. He says, I'm always it. Don't be terrified. Don't be dismayed, because I am your God. I have a personal relationship with you. And when he is your God, you never lose your way. You never lose your center. You never lose your course. As God had a close personal relationship with Lynn, Lynn had a close personal relationship with those around her. As we sat down to plan the details of today's funeral, I asked her family, those closest to her, what they'd miss the most. Here's what they said. A daughter-in-law said, the conversations, they were the best. A beautiful commentary about a mother-in-law. The conversations, they were the best. Ron said, her contagious smile and her naughty little giggle. He also said he's going to miss her saying Ronald, which meant she was serious about something. One of them simply said, her strength. Lynn Rosimo was a kind, compassionate, and tender woman. She was also strong and tough, a beautiful combination. One of them said, advice. The kind of advice that a daughter gets when she goes to her mother and she has a question about marriage, and the kind of advice that when it's given, Lynn would say to her daughters, now don't tell your husband that it was me that said that. Just make it your own. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. God is personal with us. He starts a relationship with us. And Lynn had so many of those beautiful relationships. One of them was the relationship she had as grandma. I'm the grandma, in Lynn's mind, trumped her current condition of I'm the patient. When she was having one of her last scans, even though she was a patient with cancer who needed the scan the doctor had ordered, she calmly yet clearly informed the hospital staff that after this scan, I'm leaving. I'm leaving because I have to go to my grandson's state semifinal water polo game, and if you want me to come back, I will. But after this scan, I am going. Jesus' words to his disciples made perfect sense to Lynn Rosima. Jesus said, let the little children come to me. Do not hinder them, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these. Throughout her life, you could always find Lynn Rosima on the floor with either her children or her grandchildren, down on their level to show them her love. In those short words from the prophet Isaiah, we see a God who reminds us he is present with us. We see God starting a personal relationship with us. He says, I'm with you and I'm your God. And then he just assures us of how practical that relationship is going to be for us. He makes it practical. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. In Ron and Lynn's life, God's help was practical and miraculous. From God's provision to God's intervention, again and again they could testify about their God who strengthened and helped them and upheld them. God wants you to know that when he is your God, he will make you strong. As God's help was practical in Lynn's life, Lynn's help was practical in the life of those around her. I will make you strong, God said. If anyone could help their kids and grandkids be stronger in an athletic competition by cheering from the stands, it was Lynn Rosima. She was a cheerleader. When we met together with the family, they said, did you know she was a cheerleader? And I thought they were talking about when she was in high school. No. They were talking about being a mom and a grandma who's a cheerleader. And one of her grandkids summarized it this way: she was the best one. She was the best one. Those words came from Austin, who was the recipient most recently at water polo of Grandma cheering him on. I also learned a new term from them. They said she became a tri-mom. Tri-mom. A mom that cheers on her children who are competing in triathlons and Ironman competitions. And she was all in, even one time painting Corey's number for the race on her fingernails and toenails. All in. It wouldn't be uncommon to hear these words whispered into your ear: I'm so stinking proud of you. And it didn't matter if the race was in Maryland, Mackinac Island, or the Straits, she was there. She was a tri-mom. She was also that Facebook mom who was so proud of her daughter when she was promoted to general manager, she wanted the whole world to know. I will make you strong. Those kinds of encouragements make us stronger. God's help for his people is practical. He says, I'll make you strong. And then he uses people like Lynn to make those around them stronger. God's help for us is practical. He says, I'll make you strong. He says, I will help you. And as God's help was practical in Lynn's life, Lynn's help was practical in the life of those around her. It seemed to me the more I talked with Lynn's family, the more it became difficult to differentiate between Lynn's life of helping others and Lynn's life in general. They were just one and the same. But here's a few examples. Some of you might have had Lynn as your Calvinette counselor years ago, because she was a counselor for years. Some of you might have worked with her, because for Lynn it was always easy to get a job because she knew how to help people. From Hudsonville Floral to Pizza Ranch to MBL Cleaning, over 20 years with Mary Beth, to Yonkers unloading docks and finding deals and calling her children and letting them get them before the rest of us had a chance. It was easy to get a job when you know how to help people, when that's your character. God says, I will help you. And as God's help was practical in Lynn's life, Lynn's help was practical in the life of those around her. Her daughters and daughters-in-law say she loved to paint. She painted that house on Summercrest so many times that her kids would tease her and say, Mom, the house is getting smaller because there's so many layers of paint on the wall. When one of the girls was pregnant, she was over at their house helping, and it was time to do the ceiling, and she said this to, I don't know if it was a daughter or daughter-in-law, she said, go get a chair and sit down and watch me do this. Because she was pregnant. She wanted her not to do the ceiling because she was pregnant. It didn't seem like it was up for debate at all. Just go get a chair, sit down, and watch me do this. God says to you, his people, I will help you. And as God's help was practical in Lynn's life, Lynn's help was practical in the life of those around her. Ida came up and shared some words today of gratitude for the way that she was blessed by the Rosema family. Ron told me the story about when our church here was sponsoring some refugees, and one of them was Ida and her children. It was the week that finally came where she was coming from Africa to the United States, and we wanted a contingency from church to go to the airport and welcome, you know, these new folks from Africa into the United States. And so during the week, Ron said, hey, do you want to go to the airport? And she said, you know, I'm just not feeling very good. I don't think I'm going to go. And a couple days later went by, and he said, hey, you want to go to the airport? And she says, I'm still, you know, I just don't feel good. I don't think I'm going to go. And then, like Ron, that was a couple more times he asked her, hey, do you think you want to go to the airport? Until finally he was putting his coat on and said, hey, do you think you want to go to the airport? She said, okay, I'll go. Wasn't feeling the greatest still, but she said, I'll go. And so they went to the airport. When they got to the airport, they learned that the apartment that Ida and her children were going to stay in had fallen through at the last minute, maybe even that day. And so the person in charge, I think from Para, said, is there anybody from your church do you think would be willing to provide a place for Ida and her kids for a couple of days until we can get an apartment secure? And Ron began to think about that, and before the thought even was finished processing in his mind, from right behind him, someone said, we can do that, and it was Lynn. And Ida, that's how you ended up at Ron and Lynn's house that very first night. And it wasn't a couple of days, it was a few weeks. But before they got from the airport back to Hudsonville, there were already Arby's chicken buns on the table with all the toppings to the side, because no one knew what you would like to eat or what would feel familiar coming from so far away. I will help you, God says. And he helped Lynn Rosamond her life, and she used that help to be a help to others. As God's help was practical in Lynn's life, Lynn's help was practical in the life of those around her. Just two more examples. Last week, Ron offered to let me borrow his four-wheel drive SUV to go to Chicago in the snow in order to see my dad, who recently had a stroke. His car would do better in the snow with four-wheel drive than mine. And so when he brought the car over and he was familiarizing me with all the cool kind of gadgets and things and bells and whistles that were in the vehicle, he told me about these Ziploc bags that were in the back seat. He said, oh, those are rescue bags. And I glanced at them, and first thing I saw was a granola bar. And I thought, oh, if I get stuck, that's for me to eat. And he said, no, that's not for you. He said, this is Lynn's idea. He says, when you're driving around, sometimes you run into someone who's asking for a handout, or you come across someone who's homeless. And Ron's inclination would be, well, give them $10. And Lynn said, no, you don't know what they're going to do with that $10. You need to give them something that will be practical, that will be helpful. I've heard about this idea called a rescue bag, and in it are granola bars and drinks and personal care items and everything you need that would be a blessing to your life if you're struggling, or especially if you're homeless. And so here's a woman who's in her third bout with cancer, and she is thinking about how could we be a blessing to someone we run across randomly who's homeless. And so in the back of that SUV, there are three or four bags right now, rescue bags, for the next person that Ron runs across, and I'm sure he'll give them with great joy in Lynn's honor and in her memory of the kind of person who was helped by God and thought it was perfectly normal to help someone else. I will help you, God says. As God's help was practical in Lynn's life, Lynn's help was practical in the life of those around her. And I learned just recently that Lynn's help continued beyond her death. Tuesday, on the way home from the hospital, Ron and Jennifer stopped to get some milk. The phone rang, and it was Michigan Eye Care. Lynn had signed her license long ago to be an organ donor. And so they said, here's how it works. Would you be interested in doing that? And Ron's like, no, you know, I don't know. I don't think so. And Jennifer came back out and said, hey, if Mom wanted to do that, I think we should do that. So he called back, changed his course, and said, yep, we want to do that. Giving to others, even in death. Even in death, donated eyes so that someone else might see. And it made me think, what a joy it would be if they find a match and someone else will be able to see. What a joy. And then I thought, what a greater joy if somehow in God's mysterious, miraculous economy of things, if there's a match that someone in the world would be able to see and see the world as Lynn Rosema saw it. Lynn Rosema saw the world, and she recognized God's handiwork in his beautiful creation. Lynn Rosema saw the world and she identified people who needed love and kindness and generosity and hospitality, and she did something about it. What a way to see the world through the eyes of Lynn Rosema. God's help is always practical. And when he helps us, he enables us to be a help to others. But today, as we close, I want to remind you that these promises of God from the book of Isaiah and so many other places in the scriptures are not just for Lynn Rosema. They're also for you. In her death, God is inviting you to walk in these footsteps and to take the most important steps in life that you can. The most important kind of practical help that God gives to us is when he provides us, his children, through his son Jesus, the ability to be saved from death to life. We're here with a casket, but you and I know there's more to this life than what we see. There's still something to come. And when you have a relationship with God through Jesus Christ, instead of accepting the lie or the myth about what happens when you die, you're able to accept the truth that holds you. You see, it's a lie or a myth to think that at the end of a third bout with cancer, that death finally won. I mean, in our culture, we have this image of death coming to get us. It's just a lie. It's a myth. For those who are loved by God, for those who know his son Jesus, death does not come and get you. Life swallows you up. The Apostle Paul made it perfectly clear when he wrote these words to the church in Corinth. This is how he described it. He said, "For we know that when this tent we live in, this body, when this tent we live in, this tent we live in now is taken down, when we die and we leave these bodies, we have wonderful new bodies in heaven, homes that will be ours forevermore, made for us by God himself and not by human hands. How weary we grow of these present bodies. That is why we look forward eagerly to the day when we shall have heavenly bodies, that we shall put on like new clothes. For we shall not be merely spirits without bodies. These earthly bodies make us groan and sigh. But we wouldn't like to think of dying and having no bodies at all. We want to slip into our new bodies so that these dying bodies will, as it were, be swallowed up by everlasting life." Today, our loss is Lynn's gain. Her suffering is over. Her new body is real. Thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Please join me in prayer. Our Father in heaven, we pray for Ron and his family, for children and grandchildren, for relatives and friends whose lives won't be the same. We pray, O God, that your loving and tender arms will hold them. We pray that you will continue to provide the truths of this life that will carry them. And Lord, we pray that when everything seems like it's wavering, that we will find a solid and secure place to stand with you, our rock, our refuge, and our strength. And so we come to you, O God, and we pray that you would bless them and keep them and care for them. Holy Spirit, that you would be a comforter for each of them, today, tomorrow, and in each day to come. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Today we will not be traveling to a cemetery, but we will hear the words of committal. Jesus said, "Fear not, I am the first and the last and the living one. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Because I live, you will live also. God has left the details of heaven quite a mystery, perhaps because no words can quite describe them. But he did give this vision to John, and he wrote about it in the book of Revelation, and he put it this way. He said, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Now the dwelling of God is with men, and he will live with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death. There will be no more mourning. There will be no more crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away.'" The words that describe the Apostle Paul are words that easily describe Lynn Rosema. "I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing." Today, in sure and certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to Almighty God Linnell Ray Rosema. And while her physical body remains here on earth, we place our hope in the miracle of the resurrection as we eagerly await our heavenly bodies. Amen. Please join in singing 10,000 Reasons.
Sing up.
May the Lord your God bless you. May the Lord your God cause his face to shine upon you. May he turn toward you and be gracious to you. And may the Lord your God grant you his peace, now and forevermore. And all God's people say, Amen.